We all live in a digital world. We all need it to be open and safe. We all want to trust.
And to be trusted.
We all despise control.
And desire freedom.
We are all united.
Hi, everyone. It's so nice to be here. My name is Marta Tudon, and I'm from Article 19 Office for Mexico and Central America. And it's a real pleasure and so nice to be, I think, in the last session for this day in the IGF. So welcome, everyone. And I would like to also introduce, even though I'm going to introduce them again later, to our panelists today, which are Sara Frati and Valeria Betancourt. So hi, guys. Hi, everyone. And we're here, and we have only half an hour, so I'm going to speed up a little bit. We're here to talk about what does it mean to have meaningful connectivity. Basically, we wanted to present with you, we wanted to share with you some findings we had and some reports we developed at Article 19 when we saw that we have to aim higher to end digital and social inequalities. And we have to start thinking about like in the combo approach, because otherwise when you start speaking only about regulatory frameworks or techno solutions, you know, handing technology to everyone, it doesn't mean you're really facing the issues of the digital divide. So I'm just gonna have like a brief presentation of these findings, and then I'm gonna ask please our panelists to react towards the specific question, and also the audience, if you guys want to, you know, criticize your own governments, criticize the activities of the authorities or other stakeholders, please feel free to do so. So I'm sorry if I speak a little fast, but I'm gonna try to be as clear as possible. So first of all, we wanted to analyze, like I said, in different reports, which were the implications of the pandemic in our digital rights. We developed three different reports. Two of them are already published, and the other one, the last one, is gonna be published in February or March of 2022. In the first report, we wanted to know how do you see the digital divide in Mexico? Because we know that there's a social distance we have to have because of the pandemic, but we see that the digital divide is creating other forms of social distance in terms of health, when people don't know really what to do, how to react, the best practices to handle the pandemic, also in terms of education, where the kids are, you know, trying to get their classes online, but maybe they don't have the opportunity to do this. Also people who lost their jobs or who depends on internet connection, et cetera, but also people who don't rely on internet connection to work and they do have to go, physically to do their jobs. We're talking also about entertainment, cultural access, et cetera. We want to know how, like the particularities and the characteristics of the digital divide in terms of social distance. Then in another report, we wanted to analyze and to research which was the status of the right to information. We wanted to know in which terms the right to access to public information as transparency was given. Also, what was like journalism in Mexico, as you know, is one of the most dangerous places to have this profession. So the pandemic, how does it affect our digital rights when you access the information via the social media, et cetera. And on the last report we wanted, and we're trying to figure out because we're yet to be published, the government's accountability on different issues, especially in certain topics that are really hot right now in Mexico, such as violence against women, militarization and extractive projects, etc. Extractive projects are the ones that the presidency is trying to move forward, and it's affecting a lot of communities and the ecosystem, etc. So we wanted to know and how does all the information interacted, and at the end, which were the implications in our digital rights. So the main findings of these reports, of the first one is that, like trying to find about the digital divide, we knew that, yeah, techno-solutionism helps, and also the regulatory frameworks, you know, we have a lot of regulatory things that apply only in Mexico, such as the radio, like the waves that can be accessed. I forgot the word in English, but we have a lot of regulatory frameworks that do enable people and communities, indigenous communities, to access online services and connectivity. The thing is that it doesn't really solve anything, because the authorities in Mexico, the ones that are in charge of health, of providing and guaranteeing access of connectivity, because it actually is a human right, like that it is guaranteed in our constitution, it doesn't matter that they have it in paper, because it doesn't do anything. And even though people have connection in their homes, it doesn't mean that they're really connecting or exercising their digital rights. It just meant that they had, you know, there's an antenna that kind of works, and maybe they can use it, but maybe they don't. We also found that intersectionality matters, in terms that women, indigenous people, people who are a little bit older, don't really know how to access that connectivity. So if there's a computer in their households, it doesn't really matter, because they cannot access it, they don't even speak Spanish, etc. We also found that we cannot really rely on communities to guarantee human rights for everyone, especially for women. Why do we say that? It's because in Mexico, there were like good things that developed in terms of public policy, where communities were able and were like given some resources to provide their own connection services from them, you know, like they administered it and they provided it. The thing is that when there are gender disparities, for example, or gender inequalities, and the connection is only provided, for example, in the street, in a public park, women are not allowed to go there by themselves. So they're not really exercising the same rights as men, just because they're women. So you cannot give the community the responsibility to provide human rights, because it's not their job, because they're also interacting with other kind of biases, etc. It also, there's the problem that there's one computer for a family of five, and there's work overload, again, for women, and what does it entail in terms of their ability and their exposure to the technology. Another finding of another report is that right to connect to information depends on connectivity. And this is important because in Mexico, we have a system that you can only, like, especially in the pandemic, you could only access information through a platform that is like you have to connect and you have to request an information and then you can have it. But if you don't have connection, then you don't have information about what's going on, about the vaccination, about anything. So we found out that this was really problematic in terms of the pandemic. There's also a lot of overexposure to unverified information. And if you take into account that there's no net neutrality, then when, for example, you have a specific message on your WhatsApp or in some service that doesn't have, like, that it's provided in your data services, but because of the zero rating, you cannot really compare the information you're having with the one that is really verified from a specific source online. You just have access to the same network, so you don't really have access to internet. You just have access to specific types of message services or social media. And regarding also the right to information and how it depends on connectivity, is that there was a specific effort to stigmatize the work of the press and NGOs. So it doesn't really matter that some NGO was trying to really fight hard against what was being provided online or trying to verify some content. The government had a specific job to try to stigmatize them and to disregard their recommendation. And lastly, in the report that we're going to publish in February or March, we found that there is like a disinformation strategy on behalf of the government to reduce accountability on diverse matters, which proceeds to the context of the pandemic. But if you cross this finding with the other two reports, it means that less and less information can be available, and you cannot really talk about connectivity because, or to access to information or freedom of expression, because if you cannot really compare the information you're given with real information of other networks, that you're just only fed with one same narrative, which there's a lot of control of the narrative and propaganda, which, as I said, if you cross it with other kind of findings of our other reports, it means that you're just fed with one single thing. It doesn't mean that you can really compare the data or compare what you're being fed. So that's why we wanted to redefine what we mean by meaningful connectivity, because when governments decide to promote disinformation and then the time with the press in silence, you know, people are being killed, people need to stay home for their own physical safety, then we need to redefine what it means to be meaningful connected, because that's not what is happening, as I said. So that's why we wanted to have this conversation, and that's why I would like for you, the audience, and also the first reactions of Tara and Valeria to please try to share which democratic responsibilities need to be fulfilled to achieve meaningful connectivity on behalf of all the actors that we see in these endeavors. So please, sorry if I spoke too fast. And Sara Frati, she's from Fundación Avina, and then Manelia Betancourt, she's from the Association for Progressive Communications. And you guys have 5 minutes each to please react. Complain about your governments as well, and Latin American governments, and try to give us an idea about this specific question. Thank you. First, Sara, and then Valeria.
Thank you, Marta, and everyone that is in this session. I think the pandemic gave us a lot of ideas of how important it is to have meaningful connectivity, especially in different communities that not only the traditional media, but also the traditional technology is part of the daily basis in their own communities, but to understand how we can tackle these new challenges that the pandemic and all the digital transformation that we are facing right now is giving us a lot of ideas. For example, Guatemala, which is basically we have the same challenges as in Mexico, but we are facing a lot of political challenges, which is basically a regional trend about the shrinking of civic space and how this is also impacting this kind of not only technologies, infrastructure, but also this kind, these policies and regulatory frameworks related to connectivity, but also to access to information, privacy, freedom of expression, and how all these things merge in, and at the end of the day of how people are connecting. And I think that Marta brought a lot of things related not only of how we are accessing to the internet, but how people are connecting at the end of the day. For example, having just one smartphone or one laptop that maybe is too old from all the software that people, especially, I don't know, children need to study, and how we are understanding these challenges at the end of the day. Also, there are a lot of things going on right now, not only related to education, but also related to public health, that we have been, we have been seeing a lot of these issues in the last few years, how people are left behind for not only information related to COVID, but also to the systems related to the vaccine in most of our countries too. And I think that those challenges are bigger every day, but how we can understand that is a problem for everyone. When I was reading the Web Foundation report related to how expensive it is that people are left behind on the internet, is really, is a useful way to understand these challenges for different actors that probably are not interested in bringing more connectivity and the especially meaningful connectivity to these communities. But it's also interesting how we are facing a lot of scenarios. One, for example, the lack and the digital divide, especially in indigenous communities, but how especially some countries like El Salvador are building Bitcoin cities for all the crypto boys and tech bros, and how we are, and these two bizarre narratives that people and some governments are leading in the region on how this is really toxic, not only for the environment, for the civil society environment, but how these narratives are related and are linked to authoritarian trends that we are seeing around around our governments, and how this is going to be the new normal in a few years. So we have a lot of things going on, but just those insights for now. But thank you, Marta and Valeria, and also the captioner for trying to write and understand all this conversation.
Thank you so much, Sara. I agree with you 100%. And then Valeria, please tell us why cables are not enough, and please react about the responsibilities. Yeah. Thank you,
Marta, and for the invitation, and also for the opportunity to contribute to the conversation. No doubt that the pandemic obviously has aggravated and magnified long-standing challenges and problems that are structural to our societies and that are expressed by people in multiple and intersecting forms of inequality, exclusion, discrimination, oppression, and violence. And in that context, obviously, digital exclusion and the challenges that you have mentioned, Marta and Sara, related to the right to information, and also the challenges related to government's accountability, but also the accountability of other powerful players such as the tech corporations, are critical aspects that add layers of injustice to both human and environmental systems. So I think that after 2 years of the pandemic outbreak, we are still confronting those challenges and perhaps also experiencing the effects of emerging ones. For instance, we can say that this challenge around vaccine hesitancy is being driven to great extent by a combination of fear, misinformation, cultural norms, political and ideological rifts, and also distrust of government and the pharmaceutical industry. So we can also say that in a number of countries, not only in Latin America, but all over the world, the pandemic has been used as an excuse to intensify totalitarian measures with very negative impacts on human rights. And we also know as well that the massive extraction and collection of data have reached quite unprecedented levels, whether through government initiatives in response to the pandemic or by the private sector through intensified use of internet globally. So we are actually living through a very complex situation caused by this kind of profit-driven algorithmic amplification, dissemination, micro-targeting of very corrupt and divisive information. And it is not spontaneous, but produced by coordinated schemes of disinformation with very serious damaging effects, which go from contamination of social and political discourse to damaging public safety, to actually paralyzing democratic politics and even instigating violence and death. So these powerful structures feed disinformation and benefit from it to serve a specific commercial and political interest. And I think it's very important to understand that. And in order to understand, though, the responses that are needed, I think it is crucial to acknowledge that several of these challenges that we are currently facing precede the digital era, but are expressed in a very particular way in the digital realm. And in that sense, it is imperative to not lose sight of this offline, online continuum. And I think it's also quite important to approach digital rights not as this unidirectional dynamic of receiving information, but in this proactive character that rights enable around communication processes and the agency of communities and groups to provide solutions to their own information and communication needs. So in that sense, what makes connectivity meaningful, in my view, is precisely the possibility for people to participate in building and implementing their own solutions, including the ones around organizing and providing social responses oriented to counteract disinformation through verification of information, for instance, but also through diversifying the narratives and content, and also deploying strategies to ensure a media plural and diverse environment through the existence, for instance, of independent, autonomous community media outlets and initiatives. So in other words, I think that access to connectivity can contribute to create counter narratives by giving groups affected by disinformation, for instance, access to communication tools so they can tell their stories. But this is crucial in countries like the ones in Latin America, in which traditional private media are part of the disinformation problem. And then obviously legalistic solutions, especially the ones centered on criminal law, have very poor results, and that's because we really need to go to the root causes. So the question perhaps, and in response to your initial question, so the question perhaps is, what type of connectivity is necessary for communities and groups to face disinformation and also to face digital exclusion and to face this lack of accountability by governments and with other powerful actors? And there is no single response, in my view. The responses are contextual. But I think it's possible to identify some broad responsibilities of the different actors in this regard, and obviously concerted efforts to bring in the benefits of meaningful internet access to all people are necessary in the current circumstances. And let me just finish by saying that, in my view, for instance, governments should adopt policies and regulation that enable and support community connectivity, because it is very imperative to recover these strategies to overcome digital exclusion, but to provide social-based responses to disinformation. So enabling conditions for community to exert the right to self-determine the way in which they want to occupy the digital space is crucial. It is not just to connect the unconnected, but communities, but exercising the right to decide what type of connectivity they want and what for. So I think those are some of the issues that I would like to highlight.
Thank you so much, Valeria. That's really helpful. And I really like the way you put the like layers of inequality and layers of injustice in terms of connectivity, because I think we should have named the session, which are the myths around meaningful connectivity. Because sometimes it seems like when you say connect the unconnected, those that are connected aren't really connected. Like if you're a woman, if you're indigenous, if you don't have even money to pay for light, or even you don't have the money to, you know, work, if you have to babysit three kids, that doesn't mean you have connectivity. That just means that you have a computer which has access to internet, but it doesn't mean that you can really exercise it. So that's not really meaningful connectivity. So please, if the audience has any reaction or a question, I can bring it up to our panelists. But otherwise, because we have like 7 minutes, I wanted to ask I don't see any questions or participation. 2 minutes left. No, we end at 2:35. It started at, well, I don't know what time is it there, but it started at 5 and it's supposed to end at 35. So we have 7 minutes left. Could you guys, Valeria and Sara, please give us like one closing idea that, like, think about a specific myth you have heard about meaningful connectivity, and what would you like to say about it? Just like mention it and say it doesn't happen. Like this is not the world we live in. So please, Sara, and then Valeria. Just one idea, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Meaningful connectivity is complex problem that needs a complex solution. Understanding all these levels that Valeria was saying is really important to tackle this problem in at different levels, not only at regulatory level, but also understanding the impact of digital rights on these issues. Thanks.
No, yes, I agree. And I think I would like to say that obviously these are all complex problems that need to be resolved from a holistic point of view. And connectivity, as I said, is just a part, you know, it's a part of it and can contribute to respond to specific challenges to some extent. But we have to look at what is beyond connectivity to make it meaningful. And it relates to skills, to devices, to content, but also to the regulatory frameworks and to look at the constellation of norms, standards, principles, values needed to address the challenges of the online world. Obviously, human rights gives the starting point, and then both local and global responses are needed. So global measures have to be part of the solution, of course, and we as civil society groups, I think we need to reclaim the international system to ensure a digital future that is compatible with the aspirations of a democratic and a plural society.
Thank you so much, Valeria and Sara. So we have 25 minutes and not 30, so they're asking me to please stop the session. So thanks so much for having this conversation with me. I think it was really useful. And yeah, let's think about what do we want when we speak about connectivity, and we have to aim higher. Let's not just be happy with what we have because we can aim for more. So thanks everyone. Thank you, all the participants. All